my hands are sweaty. My armpits are sweaty. I'm just going to be really honest with you this morning. Some days are like that. And I think it's the subject that it just weighs so heavily on me. Having talked to quite a few people recently whose marriages maybe aren't what they hoped that they would be. So it just feels a little weighty. I've got all kinds of things up here today. Smile and nod your head at me once in a while. That always makes me feel better. So, yeah, that's thank you. Several years ago, thank you, in the Saturday Evening Post, they published an article about the 7 ages of the married cold. And it revealed the reaction of a husband to his wife's cold during the first 7 years of their marriage. And it went something like this. The first year, sugar dumpling. I am really worried about you. I'm so much so that I am putting you in the hospital this very afternoon, and I know that the food there isn't very good. So I'm going to be bringing all of your meals from your favorite restaurant. Year number 2. Sweetheart, I don't like the sound of that cough. I called Doc Miller for you. You rest. I'll do the chores. Year 3. You'd better lie down, honey. I'll bring you something to eat. Do we have any canned soup? The 4th year. Dear, be sensible. After you've fed the kids, washed the dishes, and mopped the floor, why don't you lie down for a little while before you start supper? The 5th year. This is my favorite. Please go sleep on the couch so I can get some rest. Year 6, wash your hands after you sneeze. Are you trying to get me sick too? Maybe you should go to your mother's until you're well. And year 7, you've been sick for a week now? I've hardly noticed. And that is the decline of marriage as seen through the common cold. A funny story, but kind of not so funny either. When I first heard that story, I laughed, and I'm a germaphobe. If you know me well, you know that. So it would not have taken me 5 years to suggest that Jim sleep on the couch. But this story also struck a little bit of fear into me, too. We have this image of love that lasts a lifetime. No one stands at the altar on their wedding day and says, "Gosh, I hope we fail. That would be great. I hope it's terrible. I hope we're both miserable. I hope that my poor communication puts a wedge between the two of us. I hope that my actions convey apathy and complacency." We don't stand like that on our wedding days, do we? No, we stand with a different kind of hope. We have hope that we'll be true to our vows and that we'll keep God at the center of our relationship. We have hope that we'll weather the storms together and we'll come out stronger on the other side. We have hope that we'll have fun and laugh together and enjoy each other's company. We have hope that our marriage will be rich and fulfilling, that our home will be a sanctuary, our home will be filled with love. Home is where the heart is. Home, sweet home. A man's home is his castle. There's no place like home. It's easy to love what's lovely, isn't it? The beauty in nature, we're starting to see some flowers, that's exciting. Or maybe it's art, Michelangelo's paintings, wonderful music. And for me, that would be music by composers like Chopin or Mendelssohn or Liszt. And for Jim, that would be music that they were playing this morning. And I'm sorry you missed that, Jim. AC/DC, Queen, the Eagles. Yeah, opposites really do attract, don't they? Maybe we love something because it's valuable to us. We hang on to something because it has some worth. A baseball signed by Babe Ruth would have value. By itself, the ball's just a ball. You could get that anywhere. But now that it has Babe Ruth's signature, now it's really worth something. It has value. Sometimes we are attracted to something because it performs well. Maybe we have a favorite sports team, or a favorite athlete. Jim loves his St. Louis Cardinals and his Green Bay Packers. When he was young, he chose those teams to be his teams because they were both at the top of their performance and they were leading in all the right categories. And Jim decided if he was going to back a team, it might as well be a good one. Jim's was a performance-based decision. We often start our relationships as good performers, don't we? When Jim was coming over and we were dating, my house was clean, I smelled good, I looked as good as I possibly could, I made sure toys were picked up, I used my manners, and I fixed nice meals, I stayed up past my bedtime so we could just talk, 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 talk. And then after we were married, I fed him leftovers. I didn't always smell good. I could be grumpy or short-tempered. I didn't laugh at the jokes that I thought were funny before. I went to bed early because I was tired, and I wasn't quite as interested in all that talking. There have been great times and challenging times, easy times and difficult times, but Jim loves me through all of that. He loves me because he sees me as a person of value. He doesn't love me because I'm a person who performs well. Thankfully, God looks at us the same way. Valuable. Priceless. If my relationship with God depended on my performance instead of my value, I would always fall short. And you would too. We can never perform our way into a relationship with God. And God doesn't love us, any of us, because we're worthy, organized, religious, moral, or good. God values us simply because we live, because we breathe. And he values us and wants us so much that he sent his son Jesus to live here, to teach us, to serve us, and to die for us so that we could have that relationship and spend eternity in heaven with God. We see the signs at all the sporting events, John 3:16, and sometimes I think we get a little glazed over when we see that. But if you really think about those words, for God loved the world that he gave his only son. He loved the world. He values us. That whoever would believe in him would not perish, but would have eternal life. There's nothing in that verse about performing well and doing enough good works and enough nice things. Value versus performance. What's important in your relationships? Are you still treating your spouse the way that you did when you were dating, or maybe when you were first married? I hope so. But I think most marriages go the way of the common cold. We can become less compassionate. We can focus less on our spouse and more on ourselves. During dating, most couples are incredibly intentional about spending time together and getting to know the other person. But married couples can easily get mired down in work and kids and chores and just the busyness of life. And we lose some of that intentionality over time if we're not careful. Do you ever see couples who look like they have a great marriage and you think, how do they do that? It's such a mystery. Do you ever hear a woman talking about her amazing husband, or a husband talking about he is head over heels in love with his wife and wonder, how is it that they still feel that way after all these years, after all that they've been through? My guess is that their relationship is based on value and not on performance. As I've been praying about the message this week, I have prayed and prayed and prayed that my words would encourage anyone who's struggling in their relationships. But I also really felt convicted and led to pray for those people who think that their marriage is just fine. Those are the people who may be letting down their guard or letting down their spouse. Good marriages take work and effort day after day after day. There's an example and an expectation for us to follow regarding marriage in the Bible. And it's from Ephesians chapter 5, 21 through 33. And these are verses that can make people feel prickly. Have you ever felt that way when you've read these verses? Verse 21, out of respect for Christ, be courteously reverent to one another. Wives, understand and support your husbands in ways that show your support for Christ. The husband provides leadership to his wife the way that Christ does to his church, not by domineering, but by cherishing. So just as the church submits to Christ as he exercises such leadership, wives should likewise submit to their husbands. Husbands, go all out in your love for your wives, exactly as Christ did for the church, a love marked by giving, not getting. Christ's love makes the church whole. His words evoke her beauty. Everything he does and says is designed to bring the best out of her, dressing her in dazzling white silk, radiant with holiness. And that is how husbands ought to love their wives. They're really doing themselves a favor since they're already one in marriage. No one abuses his own body, does he? No, he feeds it and pampers it. That's how Christ treats us, the church, since we are a part of his body. And this is why a man leaves his father and mother and cherishes his wife, no longer two, but they become one flesh. And this is a huge mystery, and I don't pretend to understand it all. But what is clearest to me is the way Christ treats the church. And this provides a very good picture of how each husband is to treat his wife, loving himself and loving her, and how each wife is to honor her husband. Most people who read those verses like what the verses say regarding their spouse and how their spouse is supposed to treat you. We're all for that, women, aren't we? Yes, our husbands should love and cherish us to the max. And men like to hear that their wives are supposed to ooze respect for them. But most people aren't too terribly thrilled with what the verses are telling them to do. That's where we can get hung up a little bit. That's where the prickliness can come in. But like them or not, this is God's blueprint for marriage, for what a marriage should look like. And the Bible doesn't really give us a plan B. Nowhere in the Bible does it say, hey, if offering love and respect doesn't work well for you, then let's try this. Nope, it's just love and respect. It is a good plan. The reason that some people can get prickly over this passage is that it might be one of the most misunderstood or misused passages in Scripture in regard to marital relationships. Sadly, it's been used over time in some instances to control, manipulate, and shame rather than to free people to experience the grace that God is offering to them. You can't read verse 22 out of context without first reading verse 21. In fact, this whole marriage section stems from verse 21. Paul tells all Christians to be subject to one another out of reverence for Christ. And then he gives us our examples of what that's supposed to look like for men and women. It's tough to look at those verses without also looking at verse 18, which says, be filled with the Spirit, speaking in psalms, hymns, and spiritual songs, singing and making music, giving thanks, and submitting to each other. I don't know that I speak to Jim in psalms, but hopefully I have joy in my heart. And that is what I think Paul is saying. You want to be filled with the Spirit. And if you are, you're going to speak kindly. You're going to be full of joy. You're going to give thanks to God. And you're going to willingly submit to one another out of reverence to Christ. When we're filled with the Spirit and living our lives by the power of that Spirit, we no longer need to look to others to fill our emptiness on the inside. And we don't have to control and manipulate people to try and fill ourselves up. When we're strengthened by the Holy Spirit, we have the strength and the desire to submit to one another. But there's another way to think of that word, submit, because that's the word that I think people can get a little bit hung up on. God gives us strength, not so that we can rule over someone, but so rather we can serve. Not rule over, but serve. Jesus' entire ministry was about service, and he gave us so many great examples of service. One of the greatest was when he wrapped that towel around his waist and he washed the feet of his disciples. That was not his job. That was the job of a servant. But he humbled himself and did that job. The Greek word for submit has a meaning of coming underneath someone, not lording over them. There's a big difference. Do you see the huge difference between that? And that's the power of the Holy Spirit, coming underneath your loved ones versus living by the world standards, which says, I'm the boss, and I'm in charge of you, and you have to do what I say. The Jesus view, it's a blessing and a joy to be able to come under someone and support and encourage and teach and help that person to grow. But the worldly view says, rule over people, control and manipulate to forward your agenda. That doesn't usually go very well in a marriage. The reason that he gives can be a bit hard for some to swallow, because the husband is the head of the wife, as Christ is the head of the church. But we as the church did not submit to Jesus because he placed himself over us. Jesus never forces or bullies his way into our lives. We choose to submit because we have willingly placed ourselves under Jesus. In the same way, we are to voluntarily do that in our marriages with our spouses. Some men see this verse and they think that it means that they are large and in charge, and the family has to do what they say. And that's where I think trouble can start to happen. As wives, we ought to willingly put ourselves under our husbands, knowing that he has our best interest at heart. I think that's a pretty amazing picture of what marriage should look like. And it helps me to think about those verses in a whole different way, where I don't get defensive and prickly. I have to remind myself it's the world's way to control and boss and twist things for personal gain, but it's God's way for men to make personal sacrifices so that their wives can be the people that God intended them to be, and it's God's way for me to love and respect my spouse. There are studies that show, and of course, studies can be flawed, but there are studies that show that the vast majority of men want respect. That's their number one thing. They want to feel respected. And for women, the number one thing that we want is to be loved. These are generalizations, and they may not be true for you, but for a lot of people, they are. When most men get married, there's a switch that's moved to a spot in their brain that says permanently loved. And they don't question that. Rarely will a man wonder if his wife loves him. He might wonder a whole lot of other things about his wife, right? Don't shake your heads too vigorously. But generally speaking, a man will feel extremely confident that his wife loves him, and he doesn't need a whole lot of reassurance about that. But women can be wired very differently. Most of us don't have a switch that's moved to a permanent spot in our brains that says, forever loved and cherished. Even very secure and confident women may have this undercurrent of uncertainty or insecurity that can be dormant for a long, long, long period of time, and then suddenly, without warning, bam, there it is. I wonder if he still loves me as much as he did when we got married. I wonder if he still finds me attractive after 3 children. I wonder if he could choose all over again if he would choose me. When a wife wrestles with those thoughts and finally gets up the courage to ask her husband, do you love me? Could you give me some examples of why you love me? The husband can be a little irritated. Of course I love you. I'm here, aren't I? I provide this beautiful home for you. Can't you see that I love you? I carried the trash out last week. Does that not demonstrate my love for you? They're irritated because they don't understand it. And then what happens? Ooh. That woman feels a little bit belittled, a little bit invalidated, and doesn't feel any more secure in her relationship than she was before she asked the question. And she'll probably hesitate to ask that question again because of how her husband responded. Many of these studies also show that if a man had to give up one or the other, he would keep respect and give up feeling loved. How cool is it that all those years ago when Paul was writing those scriptures and getting that message from God, that God knew how many of us are wired. Men want to feel respected, and he's urging women to do that, to provide that, to give that. And women want to feel loved and cherished, and that's what he's asking the husbands to do. Last week, we talked about love languages and how our words and actions tend to reflect our love language rather than the love language of the person we're interacting with. So while it's a terrific thing for men to love and cherish their wives and for women to treat their husbands with respect, there might be other things needed in your relationship. That's where communication really comes in. This picture of this triangle is not new, is it? We think of ourselves, our spouse, and God. It's a three-way relationship. We've seen that before. But what I want you to think about is the importance of keeping God as your number one. That's why he's up at the top of that triangle. And keeping your spouse as number two. If I work on my relationship with God and make that my first priority, then I'm going to move closer to God. And if my spouse is doing that too, then he's going to move closer to God. And if we're both putting God first, look what happens to us. As we move closer to God, we move closer to each other. Keeping God as our number one is so important. If we spend time with our playbook, the Bible, we can learn the best way to handle situations and come up in our lives and relate to each other the way we're supposed to and have that best relationship possible. I think we all come into this world with a hole in our heart, not a real hole that you can see, but rather an emptiness or a longing. Maybe when we were growing up, it was popularity that we tried to stuff into that hole. We tried to fill ourselves up with sports achievements or acceptance by the in crowd. As we get older, maybe it was our work, our money, our spouse. We look to things to fill that emptiness, that hole. And it might feel good for a while, and it might actually work for a short period of time, but eventually the world will let us down. Someone is better than we are on the basketball court. Someone else gets the promotion and the big raise at work. Our spouse doesn't come through like we hoped. If I try to make my spouse number one, I am risking my marriage. Jim's a wonderful guy, and believe me when I say I married up. There's no mystery there. Even my own mother would tell me that I married up. But if I start to look to Jim to be my God, to make me happy, to be my be-all, end-all, then I'm setting him up on a pedestal where he does not belong. He's human. He cannot meet my needs, but God can. He can't see the bigger picture like God can. He's human. He tries to keep his word and follow through, but he's going to fall short. God is the be-all, end-all. He is the promise maker and the promise keeper every single time. My God knows my heart. He knows all of it. And Jim knows what I tell him or what he sees through his human filter. And his filter isn't always accurate or complete. Jim can't take the place of God. And when I start to get confused with that, and I elevate Jim to my number one, when I look to him for my happiness or my fulfillment, when I expect him to meet all of my needs, he's going to let me down, and my marriage is going to suffer. In Matthew 22, verse 37, Jesus says, "Love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your mind." God has to be your number one. There are so many things that clamor for our attention. Our jobs, our kids, our spouses, our hobbies, the chores that we have to do. These are all demands and distractions of life, and some of them are great, but we have to be careful not to let them become more important or more of a priority than our relationship with God, and then secondly, our relationship with our spouse. There's a story in the Bible of the time that Jesus was visiting with a Samaritan woman at a well. He was thirsty. It was noon. It was hot, and he was by himself, and he went up to that well. And this is the story out of John 4. A woman, a Samaritan, came to draw water, and Jesus said, "Would you give me a drink of water?" His disciples had gone into the village to buy food for lunch. And the Samaritan woman was taken aback. "How come you, a Jew, are asking me, a Samaritan woman, for a drink?" Jews in those days hated the Samaritans, and the Samaritans hated the Jews. And Jesus answered, if you knew the generosity of God and who I am, you'd be asking me for a drink, and I would give it to you. I would give you fresh living water. And the woman said, sir, you don't even have a bucket to draw with, and this well is deep. So how are you going to give me living water? I can imagine she was being a little bit sassy right then. Are you a better man than our ancestor Jacob, who dug this well and drank from it? He and his sons and his livestock, and they passed it on to us. And Jesus said, everyone who drinks this water will get thirsty again and again. Anyone who drinks the water I give will never thirst, not ever. The water I give will be a spring within, gushing fountains of endless life. And the woman said, sir, give me this water so I won't ever get thirsty and I won't ever have to come back to this well again. And then Jesus said, go and get your husband and then come back. And I can imagine this caught her off guard. And I can picture her hesitating and saying, I don't have a husband. That's nicely put. I have no husband, said Jesus. You've had five husbands. And the man you're living with now isn't even your husband. You spoke the truth, sure enough. Five husbands and living with someone currently. I think this woman was looking to people to fill up that emptiness inside of her. She was looking to her spouse to be her be-all, end-all. And clearly, it wasn't working. It didn't work with the first guy, the second guy, third, fourth, fifth. But Jesus was offering himself to her as living water, as the Messiah. What he was really saying was, put me first, and you will never thirst again. Put me first. I can fill up that hole inside of you. Put me first, and the rest of your life will fall into place. Put me first. You can count on me. I'll never let you down. Put me first. Put me first. Put him first. Think of that word home. What comes to your mind? And those sayings, there's no place like home. Home is where the heart is. Home, sweet home, a man's home is his castle. Some people live in an apartment, a basement, a dormitory, a trailer, a duplex, a condo, a house. But each of those places can feel like home. What makes the place that you live feel like home? Think about that word homesick. Have you ever been homesick? Oh, I have, and it's dreadful. You can be in a wonderful place with great people, and all you can think about is being home. I've never been house sick, but I have been homesick. I've never been work sick, and I like my job here a lot, but I've never been work sick. I've never been school sick. I liked high school and I liked college, but I've never been just, oh, so filled with that desire to go back to that place and that time. Home is what we long for. And if you think about what home really means, oh, this is what makes it a home. The H, honor. Romans 12:10 says, be devoted to one another in love. Honor one another above yourselves. How do my words and my actions honor those around me? How do I treat my spouse with distinction, recognition, and prestige? How do I show devotion and honor through my service to Jim? O is for others. Philippians 2, 1 through 8. And this is from The Message, and I love the way this is worded. If you've gotten anything at all out of following Christ, if his love has made any difference in your life, if being in a community of the Spirit means anything to you, if you have a heart, if you care, then do me a favor. Agree with each other. Love each other. Be deep-spirited friends. Don't push your way to the front. Don't sweet-talk your way to the top. Put yourself aside and help others get ahead. Don't be obsessed with getting your own advantage. Forget yourselves long enough to lend a helping hand. That example of Jesus, he was always about putting others ahead of himself. He lived a selfless, obedient life, and then he died a selfless, obedient death for each of us. And this whole other thing, that's the Stephen Covey principle number 5 that we talked about last week. Seek first to understand the other person. And that doesn't mean you become a doormat and you have to give up all your hopes and dreams. It just means that you are trying to create a home where you and your spouse are constantly putting the other one first, constantly trying to better understand each other, constantly trying to outserve and outlove each other and outlisten to each other. That would be a pretty cool home to be in. M stands for, well, Jim and I couldn't remember what that one stood for. And so I asked him the other day, do you remember what that M stood for? And he said, massage. And I said, this is a family-friendly church service. I don't think it's massage. And he kept eating his breakfast. And he thought for a minute and he said, it could be micromanage. And I said, no, I don't think that's it either. And then he was quiet for a few minutes. He said, I've got it. It's manipulate. And I said, you better sit in the front row on Sunday because you have some things to learn. Despite what you're thinking about my husband, he really is terrific. And the word is, can anyone guess? Mercy. Yeah, mercy. It was mercy. The definition of mercy that I like is compassion or forgiveness shown towards someone whom it is within one's power to punish or harm. When someone shows me mercy, it means that I do not get what I deserve. Luke 6:36, be merciful just as your Father is merciful. Ephesians 4:32, be gentle with one another, sensitive. Forgive one another as quickly and as thoroughly as Christ forgave you. There are times when I do micromanage. There are times when I do manipulate things for my own agenda. But luckily, as I said earlier, I married up. Jim is quick to show mercy. One time we had a disagreement, and I was ready to just light into him. I had a whole list of things that I wanted to get off my chest, and I was kind of looking forward to that, kind of clearing the air, saying my piece. And as I took a deep breath, getting ready to do just that, and this was going to feel good because some of these things I'd been hanging on to for a while, Jim said, I'm sorry. I'm not really sure how this spiraled downward, but there's nothing more important to me than you and our marriage. And so whatever it is that I did, I am so sorry. And I want to just wipe the slate clean and focus on each other. And that just sucked the wind right out of my sails. Because it's really hard to say your piece and get things off your chest when your spouse is extending such mercy. What Jim understood, and what he's so good at, is that there are times when it's better to do what's right rather than to be right. Chances are he had every reason in the world to think that he was right and that none of the things that I was going to say really mattered, but he set that all aside and instead he did what was right. He valued me, he cherished me, he loved me, and he showed me the mercy that I did not deserve, but I was grateful to have. E is for edify, and that means to build up. It's a verb. It's an action. It's to instruct and improve, especially in moral and religious knowledge, to uplift, to strengthen. First Thessalonians 5, verse 11, therefore encourage one another and build each other up. What would our relationships look like if we were committing ourselves to building each other up, encouraging one another? What if we asked our spouse questions like, hey, how can I pray for you today? Or how can I best support you today? What do you need from me today? That'd be a great way to start our day. What does your home really feel like? Is it a place where honor and respect are practiced and others are put first, and mercy and love are extended extravagantly? Is edification the norm? Is it a place where you come under your spouse to offer your best so that they can be their best? You may have a long list of things you want to change in your spouse, but I would suggest that you start with yourself. What needs to change in you? And how will you start making those changes? Is your marriage relationship based on value or performance? Home. Home. Home is what we long for. And when we follow the example of Jesus, there really is no place like home. Let's close with prayer. Oh God, marriage is hard. Relationships are hard. Thank you for being our coach. Thank you for your word. Thank you for your example through your son, Jesus. Help us to think about what needs to change in each of us so that our homes really can reflect you, so that we can come up underneath our spouse and even our children and help them to be all that you created them to be. Help us to not get prickly. Help us to not just further our own agenda. Please, God, help us to focus on you as our number one and our spouse as number two. Help us keep our priorities straight. And as we leave this place, Lord, I hope that there's great communication within families, within husbands and wives, in the car ride home, around the table for lunch, for dinner. What can we do to make home a reality for each of us? Speak to us, God. Give us the wisdom that we need that only you can provide, so that we can do all that we can to reflect your love in our homes. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. Before you head to the door and start having those really awesome conversations, be sure to pick up one of these on your way out. There's a team of people that's praying for our building project, and that's exciting that they have dedicated themselves to really being focused on prayer for the growth of this church and how we can best serve going forward. And they spent a lot of time on this. There's some devotions for you. There's a prayer reminder card. There's information about what's coming up with the meetings. And could we just take a quick moment and pray for this? This is really an important time in our church family and in our church history and our church going forward. And we want to make sure we are all covering that. So we'll just say a quick prayer for that and then be sure to pick this up on your way out. And thanks to the people who put these together. I can only imagine that this took quite a bit of time. I don't know who those people are. Kim Borden's one of them. Erica Borgo's another one. And I don't know who the others are. But man, ask who did this. This is great. And I appreciate that. It's going to be nice to keep this front and center on my kitchen counter so that I can be thinking about this and praying about this and enjoying the devotions that are a part of this. God, we want so much to serve you well. We want to be your hands and your feet in all that we do. We want to serve each other well within these walls, but we really want to get outside of these walls too. We want to bring your message of hope and love to the people who desperately need to hear that. God, we ask you to be at the very center of the meetings, the discussion, the talks, the questioning, the financial giving, all of it. We want you at the very center, so that we're sure that we're doing the things that you want us to do in the way that you want us to do them, and so that we can continue to be your hands and feet. The ripple effect, I love that name, God, because it's really cool to think about all that's going to happen, not just a building, but what the building is going to allow us to do to serve and glorify you and to spread your love to those who need to hear it. In Jesus' name we pray, we thank you, we love you, Lord. Amen.